And good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Sunday live streaming, Integrating A Course in Miracles. And this is Reverend Deb Phelps.
And this is Reverend Paul Phelps.
And we welcome you today, March 5th, 2017. And we are in the midst of our 40 Days of Light series that we're doing. We just started on March 1st. It's a new way to look at Lent, the Course in Miracles way to look at Lent. So that's what we're doing. We're sending out daily short messages. And then on the Sundays, this is the first Sunday of Lent. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to be talking today about the Holy Spirit never asks for sacrifice. So Paul's going to start us off with a opening prayer, and then we'll get started for today.
Okay. All right. Let's join together in prayer. If you would, please just close your eyes and join with us. And just take a deep breath and just start letting go. Allow your minds to begin to settle down and relax and let go. Feel yourself sinking into that peaceful place inside of you. Where you know your friend, the Holy Spirit, resides, who is always with you, ready to help you in any and every way. We just need to remember but to ask Him for that guidance and that help, and to take a moment to listen. And as we listen, we discover that He will lead us along the way. He will lead us out of pain and into joy. He is there to be our friend, our helper, our comforter in all situations. What a wonderful gift. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you, Paul. So, as I said, our topic today is the Holy Spirit never asks for sacrifice. And our focus quote today is the Holy Spirit always sides with you and with your strength. And, you know, this whole idea of sacrifice, when we look at how perhaps we've looked at Lent in the past, certainly, you know, we both grew up Catholic. Lent was a time of sacrifice and all sorts of.
Yeah. I know for us it was, I'm going to give up chocolate or soda pop for 40 days or ice cream, which was, as a kid, that was pretty challenging for us.
Sure. So, but the Holy Spirit, or Jesus, I should say, in A Course in Miracles, is teaching us something that's a little bit different. And that's with this whole idea of these 40 days of light that we're doing. And we started off slowly with building our intention. Lighting a candle was day two, as we just remembered, well, what is the truth about us, the light that is within us. And then next, just taking some deep breaths, just being grounded in that space. And then day four started to get into some thoughts, and that was yesterday, day four, which is accept what God created. I am sinless. And so each day I'm coming up with these by going into meditation, and you know what it arises for me. And what came to me was that thought of original sin. Now, if you grew up Catholic like we did, you know, there was that idea that there was original sin. And supposedly, the whole idea of Lent and then, you know, the crucifixion and that sort of thing, it was God sacrificed His Son for us because of our sin. And certainly, A Course of Miracles turns that around for us. And in this reading today that we'll be highlighting, we're going to have two readings today. Let me put those up on the screen there. The two readings will be text chapter 7, section 10, the confusion of pain and joy. And then as we end today, we'll be looking at lesson 190, I choose the joy of God instead of pain. And those both together really show us, you know, what we don't need to do, right? We don't need to sacrifice. We don't have to experience pain in any way. So, you know, in this reading, so let me tell you, it's on page 133 in your course book. And there's some different ideas that Jesus brings up here. Is that, you know, that the Holy Spirit will direct us to avoid pain.
Yeah.
And even that right there, we don't have to suffer.
Yeah.
You know, pain is optional or suffering is optional. We don't have to go to that idea of no pain, no gain, right? Or we have to sacrifice in any way so we will be rewarded in that sense.
I think one of the things that right in the beginning of that section, Jesus has a discussion about the idea that our mind, our ego minds, are totally confused about everything. Uh-huh. And we really don't know the solution to anything. We're always confused.
Right.
We're always concerned about, you know, what is it that I need to do next to try to find happiness in my life and a sense of peace and fulfillment? And there's always this striving and then feeling like we're making mistakes. Mm-hmm. The ego is confused. The body's mind will never figure it out. And the sooner we come to the realization, the better. And once we begin to kind of accept that idea and come to a place of surrender, now we begin to open up to, well, what is the solution? And as Deb's sharing here, the Holy Spirit is the solution. It's the only solution. So he goes into that whole discussion.
Right, exactly. And that is the solution. And that tiny, mad idea when we forgot who we were, you know, we wanted something better, you know, in step the Holy Spirit to bring us to our right mind. And he's there. Now, we know from the course that it's all over. Yeah. And we're just kind of reviewing everything, so to speak. And in that, you know, knowing that we have the Holy Spirit within us to guide us, to share with us that we don't have to have this sense of sacrifice, you know, letting that pain that we believe. So we have two things that we can look at in this today. Is one is that we think that we're separate from God. And so we think we're going to be punished. And we're sacrificing our true self and what God created, you know, that we are sinless, we are innocent, that sort of thing. But then it also plays out in our lives, too, in various ways. And so, you know, there's the one piece where, yeah, you know, we think we're separate from God and think we're separate from everyone in that sense. And then, you know, okay, well, what do I do here in the world? How can I use this to help me? And to know that I don't have to let go of who I am. You know, we always hear the language of, you know, I sacrificed for my kids, or I did this, you know, or gave up my chocolate, or, you know, whatever it is. Mm. And it's like, well, why are we doing that? You know, well, what's the intention? What is it for? And if it's to inflict guilt, whether you know, self-guilt or on someone else, well, then is that really worth it in the long run, you know?
Yeah. I spent some time kind of listening in meditation, and one of the things I got was to ask, to really to invite everyone to ask themselves if you're feeling spiritually sick in any way. Mm-hmm. And And I really was like, oh wow, that's, because I kind of went through that myself many years ago, where I was spiritually sick inside. On the outside, I was doing all kinds of things to construct a world and a life around me that was going to make me feel successful, happy, and fulfilled inside. And after many years of going down that path, and actually achieving many of those goals, when I got to the end, I still felt very spiritually sick and unfulfilled. And that was really depressing for me in a way, because I had spent so much time and effort in coming up with my own plan
Plan.
for my own
Right,
happiness and
right.
joy. And so when I achieved all those things and I was still feeling sad and depressed inside and spiritually sick, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what the solution
Didn't know
was.
what the remedy was,
Yes,
to that
right.
sickness, it's that ego virus that, you probably
Yeah.
can't tell, we have a bit of a
Yeah.
cold,
Yeah.
and I haven't been myself. Well,
Yeah.
that's what it
Yeah.
is we're not ourselves. We're not
Right.
our true selves. We're separated from that true self, so to speak, within our mind, and we need that remedy.
Yeah. And the reason for that, so the way we're brought up is we're totally distracted with everything outside of us, and we think that, we grow up to believe that the solution is outside of us. And what's so wonderful about A Course in Miracles for myself is when it came into my life and I began working with the lessons within the workbook for students, Jesus helped me to learn how to start going within to begin to discover some very wonderful gifts inside of me, some very wonderful spiritual gifts. And it was the gift of truth about who I really am, through miraculous miracles, miraculous experiences. And once that starts to happen, now you start to let go. Your mind starts to let go of the confusion that things outside of you are going to bring you joy. You start to come to this realization that's part of the gifts. And then that, once you know that, once you start to have, you're like, oh, I'm really a spiritual being, and I'm connected to a much greater thing than this body and the things around me. When you start to have those personal connection experiences with that truth by going in, within deep meditation and those experiences, you that sense of security and safety and peace starts to return to you, and you start to become grounded and certain, like, oh, I'm gonna be okay.
Right, and that brings joy.
Exactly.
That brings the joy to our lives. It brings the peace to our lives when we do that. When we realize, well, I don't have to suffer to enjoy my life. As a woman and a mother, and I was a single parent, many of those years, or just even as a parent, we say, well, we have to sacrifice for our children. And what we have to look at is, sometimes when we say this word sacrifice, for our children or whatever, is that what we're really saying is I'm a victim. I'm putting someone or something, like God, here we are, we're going to be punished, because, we sacrificed the love of God, so to speak. But the thing is that when we say this idea of sacrifice, sacrificing for my kids, is we have to turn it around and take self-responsibility and say, well, I choose to work a job to take care of my family, or I choose, very simply, like to cook dinner for my family, or that sort of thing, or I choose to go without some items so my kids can have a good college, whatever it may be. instead of saying I'm sacrificing, it has such a negative tone to it. And like I said, there's like a like I'm being victimized by this other person. And the truth is, what am I choosing? So it's looking at what am I choosing, and what is it that I really want? What's really behind there? And so when I look at that in my own life, I have to really take that step of responsibility. I have to really look at, well, what is it? I've made choices, and this is what's going on. And I can choose otherwise. I can choose to walk with the Holy Spirit. I can choose joy instead of pain. And instead of always feeling like this dark cloud, under me. And I can choose to eat chocolate, or I can choose not to eat chocolate. It doesn't have to be this weighing heavy thing, because Jesus tells us that he was not punished or crucified because we were bad. It's not this particular section, it's in another section, but that's what he tells us. It's not because we're so sinful and we're horrible creatures that he, was hung up on the cross. No, that whole thing, and we'll get into it as the weeks go on, as we get closer to Easter, was to show us that that was the last useless journey that we had to take.
One of the when you know when I know when you practice this choosing too, a really important factor here is that we're going within and choosing with the Holy Spirit, or actually asking the Holy Spirit, what would you have me do? In the in this text section, Jesus talks about we get to a point where as we work with the Holy Spirit and we learn how to listen to Him and begin to follow His guidance, we start to realize that we really can't make decisions for ourselves. And there are no the only decision that to make is to make a decision with the Holy Spirit, or let Him kind of make it for us. He even says here, he says that the
What
Holy,
section are you in?
I'm in the confusion of pain and joy section, looks like 10. That's chapter 7, section 10, paragraph
Right.
3.
Right. Okay, so in paragraph three.
Paragraph 3, the Holy, excuse me. The Holy Spirit will direct you only so as to avoid pain. Cool. I like that idea.
Who
Now,
doesn't?
yeah.
Who doesn't?
The trick here though is the problem for me and everyone else is not whether that the whole whether what the Holy Spirit says is true, but whether you want to listen to what He says.
It's a key line
And I'll
there.
carry that even for to do what He says. And also there's another factor. It's our own personal confidence in our ability to believe, in our own, it's that confidence. One of the things that the ego does all the time, it raises doubt. When we go within and we say, okay, Holy Spirit, I really would like to experience this, for example. And today I'm going to practice going within and asking you, what would you have me do next, And then you get something back. The problem is a lot of times, if it's not the clear, audible voice coming from the Holy Spirit, which a lot of times it isn't, it can be, but as we're learning how to hear in the beginning, it may come as a, a kind of a quiet thought or a feeling. And so the ego will raise doubt. Well, was that really the voice of the Holy Spirit? So one of the things that I do to help kind of break through that particular problem is the confidence problem is when you go within and you ask for some guidance on what to do next, just be in silence, and what comes up, if it feels peaceful and it feels okay, go ahead and try it. Go ahead and follow that and do it. And then pay attention to what the outcome is. Did it bring more joy into your life? Did it bring more peace into your life? And then do it again. And then do it again. You can even do it through journaling. And
Right.
as you see the results of the actual practicing, you will grow in that confidence, and you'll like, wow, this isn't that hard. It actually is pretty easy to listen and get guidance from the Holy Spirit. And a whole new joy about that realization is going to rise up inside of you.
Right. So, and I think that's so fantastic. And some other thoughts that he gives in this reading too is that, you know, that the Holy Spirit's not going to ask for sacrifice, but the ego will.
Yeah.
And that's the one thing to remember is that the ego always does. And so when you're confused about this distinction in motivation, and I'm in paragraph 5 now, it can only be due to projection. Projection is a confusion in motivation, and given this confusion, trust becomes impossible. So when we're confused, how are we going to trust?
Yeah.
You know, right? So a little further down, paragraph 7, he says, his voice will teach you how to distinguish between pain and joy and will lead you out of the confusion you have made. So we have this cloud over us, this spiritual sickness, as you said. And, you know, I know for me, I'm kind of foggy right now with my cold thing going on here. And, you know, it's like that voice, you know, it's that song, it's that whatever, that's that light in the darkness that's calling us forth and saying, hey, you don't have to believe you're separated from God anymore. You don't have to believe you're separated from anyone else here anymore. You know, accept who you really are and choose God. Choose God. So let's go into that reading.
Yeah, this is a great segue for that, because what this is all about too, at least a big part of this, is for a long time we can go on believing that we don't have a choice. That we don't have a choice. And one of the big lessons from Jesus and from the Holy Spirit is that we do have a choice. And in this lesson that we're going to go into here, I choose the joy of God instead of pain, is actually a lesson in the practice of going within when we're feeling spiritually sick and we're feeling lost, of going within and saying, okay, Holy Spirit, show me this joy of God instead of pain. And that's when these miracles start to happen. And you start, you know, a wave of peace comes all of a sudden. And you start to, with practice, you're like, wow, I can choose. I don't have to feel spiritually sick all the time. I can step back, go within, and wait for that wave of peace to come, or wait for the light to come, or the whatever miracle experience happens to you. There's things that you know, you have a choice. You're not a victim.
Right, and so this lesson is just so wonderful for that. You know, as you said, Paul. So it's lesson 190. I choose the joy of God instead of pain. And some pieces in here is, you know, pain is a wrong perspective, for one. That's a paragraph one. And then two, paragraph two, pain is but witness to the son's mistakes and what he thinks he is. You know, we think that we're this body. We think that we're separated from God in this world, that we think we're separated from everyone else in that way. And then in paragraph three, he says, pain is a sign illusions reign in place of truth. It demonstrates that God is denied, confused with fear, perceived as mad and seen as traitor to himself. If God is real, there is no pain. If pain is real, there is no God. And then he goes, well, peace to such foolishness. And then he gives us a real eye-opener in paragraph 5. And this is one to really pay attention to. It is your thoughts alone that cause you pain. Nothing external to your mind can hurt or injure you in any way. There is no cause beyond yourself that can reach down and bring oppression. No one but yourself affects you. There's nothing in the world that has the power to make you ill or sad or weak or frail, but it is you who have the power to dominate all things you see by merely recognizing what you are. As you perceive the harmlessness in them, they will accept your holy will as theirs. And what was seen as fearful now becomes a source of innocence and holiness. So this idea that it's our thoughts alone that causes pain, nothing outside in the world can cause us that pain, because it doesn't exist, for one, even though we think it does. You know, we walk through this world and we think we're here. And the thing is, it's our own perception, it's our own attitude that we can have as we go through our life. Now, certainly in my life in the past, you know, pre-course, early course, even occasionally now, I could still have these thoughts that come up, or things that happen, these situations where I think I'm being unfairly treated, or I think I was betrayed, or I think I'm unsafe, or I think I've been given the shaft, or whatever it may be, you know. And a lot of times, as I've been speaking recently on the Facebook group, because we've been talking about these 40 days of light, and I shared about the self-critical thoughts that can creep up. Sometimes it's really weird, because what's been happening is sometimes when I'm out driving, you know, I'll start having these, you know, really weird thoughts, like, you know, oh, you're so stupid, you know, well, why did you do that? All those, I'm sure everyone, I know everyone has these self-critical thoughts, right? And it just so happens it starts popping up. And so that's why, too, that I really like the message that I sent out yesterday about accept what God created. I am sinless. So when these thoughts started coming up, and it's like, well, I could have went with it in the past, years ago, I would have went with that, and I would have believed, and I did believe, you know, how stupid I was, or how unintelligent, or whatever, how ugly, those sorts of thoughts. I believed them to the point that I brought witnesses to myself in past marriages that really taught me how much I hated myself. But in this, now I have that choice where I don't have to go with those thoughts. I don't have to go with the self-critical thoughts. They arise. And the thing is that we're here in the world, these thoughts are going to arise. It's just what happens. And the thing is are we going to listen to them? Are we going to attach to them? Or are we going to remain detached? And that is what we do. We choose something else instead. And so remembering, you know, I am innocent. I am innocent in all of this. And that's what's really been helping me, even though it's been weird that these have been popping up. But I celebrate them. I appreciate them coming up, because it shows me what else needs to be healed in my mind.
Yeah, I'd like that. You know, that's awesome, because that's what everybody goes through. And I go through my own stuff. And the nice thing about the solution is that it doesn't take, it's a very simple practice to restore your peace. And I know you practice that on a daily basis. I practice it on a daily basis. You know, even though the form is changing, I go through similar stuff where I start to worry about things. I worry about things going on in my workplace and in my job and in my duties and responsibilities. I find myself worrying about relationships or things I think I need to do or accomplish. And just normal life stuff. We start to worry and start to feel anxious. And the very simple practice that I'm getting to is taking that time every day. When you catch yourself kind of becoming chronically worried in over a day or two, if you're forgetting to go within, take some time to sit down in a quiet place and go within, because that's the key to happiness. And when I practice that, and I kind of take the things that I'm worrying about, see, and I tell the Holy Spirit or tell Jesus, whoever, or even Father, whatever you feel in the moment, hey, these are the things that I'm worrying about. I'm coming to you for some counsel, for some help, for some relief. And then we wait in silence, in quiet expectation, for that help to come. And I often begin to, all of a sudden, a wave of peace will just flow through me. And I'll be, ah. And It's a release. It's a gift of release from a power greater than ourselves, from a higher part of ourselves. And that is a step in the right direction. That is a step towards the light within us. And when it happens too, when that relief and that peace comes to you, now you feel safer. You feel more secure. You feel grounded. And as you go on with your day, you're calmer and you feel, everything, you're like, everything's okay. I don't have to worry about this stuff. And so that's the gift. And it's a simple practice. It only takes, 5, 10 minutes a day, maybe a couple times a day if you want, because we forget. And so we have to constantly remind ourselves to do that and to go in and that is the way we practice choosing joy instead of pain.
Well, it sounds like a good segue into actually practicing.
Oh, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm.
Do you want to go ahead and lead us in this practice?
Okay, so I'll tell you what, let's start off with a practical application here. So if you would please, let's close our eyes. Just set your course books aside if you have them with you or whatever. And wherever you are, hopefully you're in a place where you can kind of relax a little bit. Just close your eyes and take a few deep breaths. And just allow yourself to begin to melt. Feel all your muscles just relaxing and letting go. Allow your mind to settle down. Become still. And right now, let's just spend a moment, a minute maybe, and allow things that you have been worrying about lately to come to your mind. Reflect on, just allow it to come to your conscious mind, just so that you become aware of it. You know, and just relax and become aware. Oh, okay, I've been worrying about this a little bit. This situation has been bothering me a little bit. Just allow a few of those to come to mind for you. We reflect on these things that are worrying us a little. Become aware of that pain it brings you. A little bit of spiritual sickness. The stress. You feel stress in your body, maybe in your chest. Around your head. You feel yourself tensing up a little bit. So some of that, some of that is physical pain. And you also have perhaps emotional pain or anxiety, psychological pain and fear maybe. And often it's very subtle, but it is pain. So now that we're aware of that, say quietly to yourself, together with me right now, I choose the joy of God instead of pain. I choose the joy of God instead of pain. can now take a moment to ask the Holy Spirit to take these concerns that you have away from you. Hand them over. Maybe visualize yourself kind of handing over each of those items that you feel concerned about. And tell the Holy Spirit, say, I want to give these to you now because I really don't want to be in this pain anymore. It's wearing me out. I feel exhausted, even fatigued. I'm tired of having trouble sleeping because I'm worrying about these things. So I really would like to give these to you now. And this is my invitation to you to help restore peace in my life. So as you see yourself handing them over to the Holy Spirit, do you feel that stress being relieved a little bit, perhaps, as you hand it over and give it to Him to take care of for you? Just feel yourself relaxing and letting go and relieved of those painful thoughts, those painful worries. Feel a little bit of that peace restoring now, and perhaps a little bit of a sense of well-being coming back to you a little. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for that sense of relief we're feeling already, even if it's just very subtle, but it's a shift. It's a step in the right direction. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for taking care of this for us. And if there's anything you would have us do, you will let us know. But in the meantime, I just don't want to worry about this anymore. And I want to learn this lesson of choosing joy, the joy of God. Finish showing me how this works. And I'm just going to rest here in quiet now and in openness for anything else you would like to bless me with right now. So I'll just wait in quiet openness for even a deeper gift of peace to come to me now. We'll rest here for another minute or so. Just soak in peace and openness. are ready, let's slowly bring our attention back to wherever we are, bringing that peace with us. So hopefully you have experienced some relief from any concerns that you were feeling, and actually you feel a little bit more peace now. And we just rested in that place of silence and openness and peace for just a minute or two. If you continued on for another 5 or 10 minutes, normally that peace will get even deeper, that sense of peace, and maybe even waves of peace will come to you. Mm-hmm. And other gifts from the Holy Spirit will begin to come to you as you continue to practice. And now you can go on with your day feeling a little bit more grounded and a little bit more secure. And that is an example of, I choose the peace of God or the joy of God instead of pain. And it's not that hard. Just takes a little bit of practice.
Just a few minutes, really. Yeah. That's all it takes, just that determination. So, as we said earlier, if you are interested, or if you've been part of the 40 Days of Light, if you still want to be part of that, just go to 40daysoflight.org, or you can go to our website at www.miraclesone.org. As we will continue through this period of Easter time, to share daily messages, and then on the Sundays we'll have some things and some things in our podcast that we'll be sharing as well to assist you as you go forth. Next week we will not be live streaming, as we will be having our Madison meeting, and we will be talking about the real meaning of sacrifice, which will also be a podcast that I'll do too. So you'll get that benefit as well, even though we won't be live streaming on next Sunday. And then we will return to live streaming on March 19th as we continue from Lent to Easter with A Course in Miracles. Just remember that our website, www.miraclesone.org, has free resources for you for your study and practice of A Course in Miracles. And as always, we thank you and we wish you peace. Namaste.
Namaste.
Make your donation today by going to donate.miraclesone.org.